Thank you, Marcus, for the introduction and also, of course, for the very nice invitation. I'm really pleased to be here and to present some of my work. This summer school approaches the development of Kant and of early post-Kantian philosophy from the angle of Kant's notion of transcendental idealism. Yes, so this has been discussed a lot. And I agree there are a number of reasons of doing so, of focusing on this notion of idealism. First of all, primarily perhaps through Allison's work, the term transcendental idealism is very often used to identify Kant's philosophy. So it's considered to be the term that tells us basically everything we want to know about Kant's theoretical philosophy. Moreover, Fichte and Hegel, of course, also use versions of the term, so it's a nice way to connect Kant to his to those who came after Kant. However, I think that the term idealism is rather one-sided and covers one aspect of that which Kant has in common with philosophers such as Fichte and Hegel, and does not allow us to fully grasp the intentions of Kant's theoretical philosophy. So for that reason, I think that the term transcendental idealism has been overused and perhaps also has been abused in a certain sense. To support this, we can take a look at the first quotation on the handout, which has already been mentioned by Marcus during the discussion, which is basically Kant's own definition of transcendental idealism. And he says, I understand by transcendental idealism, of all appearances, the doctrine according to which they are on the whole regarded as mere representations and not as things in themselves. So it seems to me that this view on appearances is just a starting point. Yes, it's not really the claim that Kant wants to get across, it's the starting point, namely his invitation to limit the domain of investigation to that which is imminently given to the reflection carried out by the philosopher. So once we decide to do philosophy, we have to create the domain of investigation, and this is done by arguing that we should limit ourselves to that which is given to the senses and not try to move beyond. However, the reflection carried out by the philosopher itself is not really concerned with appearances. Yes, it's not really the issue at stake in this reflection carried out by the philosopher. Because the philosopher who decides to take up this transcendental stance is concerned with the a priori principles or structures that allow the mind to turn appearances into objects of cognition. Yes, so the focus is on the a priori elements of cognition. One of the problems that I have with the use of the term transcendental idealism is that it takes the critique of pure reason as a whole to consist in a systematic account of the conditions of possibility of experience. Now, of course, I'm not going to deny that this is one way of framing what's going on in the critique of pure reason, but I think that there are other elements that are more important. One of them is Kant's crucial distinction, to which I will come back later on in the paper, his crucial distinction between critique on the one hand and system on the other hand. And I also find the term transcendental idealism somewhat problematic because it tends to confirm the view that Kant's account suffers from a certain kind of subjectivism that Fichte and Hegel are trying to overcome. As you will notice as I go along, I disagree with the portrayal of Kant's philosophy as subjectivist. And I think that we cannot properly understand what's going on in the development from Kant to Fichte to Hegel by framing this development in terms of Kant's alleged subjectivism to a certain kind of absolute idealism that we attribute to Hegel. And in this regard, I would like to recommend a book by Grandjean in French entitled Critique et Réflexion, published by Vrin in 2009. And he, in a similar way, goes against, I think, the mainstream picture of the development from Kant to Hegel. So what I would like to do in this paper is to, ignore idealism, ignore subjectivism, and try to sketch the development from Kant to Fichte to Hegel by starting from Kant's efforts to transform metaphysics into a science. Yes, and this theme, in my view, has nothing to do with subjectivism. Now, evidently, the term metaphysics has its problems as well, yes, and I won't be able to discuss them in detail. I just can mention that the contemporary debates on Hegel, especially Hegel's logic, are debates that pivot around the opposition between metaphysical and non-metaphysical, yes? So, it seems to me that this way of framing the issue is also not very satisfactory, because it would require to, in order to determine whether Hegel's logic is metaphysical or not, we would have to have a very good understanding of what Kant and Hegel meant by metaphysics and its various elements. And I think that this more historical understanding is often lacking from the debates. Okay, so for the moment I won't say a lot about metaphysics, but my point will be that even though Kant and Hegel had different views on the task of metaphysics, that there is much more continuity between their positions than may appear at first sight, yes, if we look at their conceptions of metaphysics. And I will try to clarify this by starting from the distinction between general metaphysics on the one hand and special metaphysics on the other hand. And I take this distinction to be very important to Kant. It's a distinction that Kant took over from his Wolffian predecessors, and I think it deeply informs his own understanding of metaphysics and also that of Hegel. So, to put it very briefly, I take it that Kant, in the Critique of Pure Reason, wants to turn metaphysics into a science, basically by transforming the first part of metaphysics, the most fundamental part of metaphysics, that is to say, general metaphysics. And as he saw it, this part of metaphysics consisted basically in a rigorous investigation of the basic principles of cognition. Yes? Now, the interesting thing is that that Wolff and also Kant took this part of metaphysics, general metaphysics, to be ontology. Yes? But in my very brief description of this first part of metaphysics, the term being or similar terms did not occur. Yes? So I take it that Kant saw the essence of general metaphysics to consist in a basic reflection on the principles that allow us to turn something into an object of cognition in the first place. And the term being does not really have to be involved in that description. And it seems to me that that Kant's effort to modernize, in a way, this part of metaphysics, general metaphysics, was taken over by Schelling, Fichte, and Hegel. Yes, of course, not without transforming it, but still. Okay, so this, as regards to continuity between Kant and early German idealism. On a more critical note, I would like to argue that this development, let's say, of German idealism, partly depends on an inadequate understanding of Kant's distinction between critique and system. And the last point that I want to make is that, well, probably because of this inadequate understanding of Kant's own intentions, Fichte and Hegel could develop a method that allowed them to achieve a complete system of pure reason. Yes, that is to say, in a way to fulfill Kant's dream. Yeah, although by means which are very different from anything that Kant could have imagined. Okay, so I will now move to a few elements of the Critique of Pure Reason that I think are very relevant to understanding the development of German idealism. Now, first of all, I will make remark that in a way has also been made by Catherine Malabou 2 days ago, which is to say that Kant in the Critique of Pure Reason basically wants to investigate the conditions of possibility of metaphysics. Yes, so the Critique of Pure Reason, on my reading, is not primarily concerned with investigating the conditions of possibility of experience. No, he's concerned with, Kant is concerned with investigating the conditions of possibility of metaphysics itself, that is to say, of synthetic a priori cognition. Yes, so he wants to determine under which conditions synthetic a priori cognition is possible. And Kant calls this investigation transcendental critique. Yes, and he tells us that this critique, transcendental critique, must pave the way for a system of pure reason, which is what he also calls the theoretical part of metaphysics. Yes, this is quotation 2 on your handout. So Kant announces that he hopes to deliver a system of pure speculative reason under the title of Metaphysics of Nature. And he contrasts this system with the critique, which has a propedeutic function, as he puts it elsewhere, namely to display the sources and conditions of the possibility of this system, yes, of metaphysics as a system. And Kant also determines, he further determines this metaphysics of nature as the, and this is not on your handout, as the inventory of everything we possess through pure reason ordered systematically. Yes, all the elements that we possess through pure reason and which have to be ordered systematically. And as you probably know, Kant thought that it would not be a big deal to actually establish that system. Yes, with a little help from his friends, he thought that would be very doable. But then for some reason, the friends were too ill or not interested, and Kant himself may not have known exactly how to go about it, but I think that the more likely reason why he never sat down to write the system is that he got more interested in practical issues and also in a more popular presentation of his insights. Okay, so. We do not know a lot about the system such as Kant intended it, let's say, around 81 and the years prior to that. We know some things about it from the architectonic, of course, in which Kant tells the reader that the system would have been divided into two main parts. Well, I will limit myself to the theoretical part of the system, leave out the stuff on ethics. So the theoretical part of the system would have been structured in a twofold way. The first part would have been or would at least have corresponded to general metaphysics, the second part would have corresponded to special metaphysics. That is to say, the first part of the system does not treat of any things in particular, but merely of the concepts and principles that allow us to achieve knowledge of things at all. Yes, and these principles are precisely the principles that must be presupposed by all other sciences. So what I just said, I think, applies to Kant, but equally applies to Wolff's conception of general metaphysics or ontology. Yes, so quote three is taken from Wolff's Discursus, and he mentions a number of concepts, metaphysical concepts such as essence, existence, property, necessity, contingence, place and time, and so on. And he then writes that neither psychology nor physics can adequately explain these concepts, because we require these concepts and the principles derived from them in psychology and physics, as well as in all other parts of philosophy. So the way I've put it so far suggests that what Kant and Wolff wanted to achieve in the first part of the system is pretty similar. And I think that a passage from the Architectonic confirms this point. It's quotation four on the handout, where Kant repeats the distinction between general metaphysics and special metaphysics, but uses different terms. Yes, he used the term transcendental philosophy on the one hand and physiology of pure reason on the other hand. So the what he here calls transcendental philosophy, and which corresponds to general metaphysics, considers, he says, only the understanding and reason itself in a system of all concepts and principles that are related to objects as such, without assuming objects that would be given. Yes, and between brackets he adds, well, this is what used to be called ontology. Yes, so an ontology in this sense does not assume objects that would be given. It just reflects on the principles constitutive of our knowledge of objects as such. Okay, now of course Kant has reason to replace the term ontology or general metaphysics with the term transcendental philosophy. Of course he is critical of the term ontology, basically because the term such as Wolff uses it, means that this first part of metaphysics is concerned with the principles constitutive of our knowledge of things as such. Yes, with the emphasis on things as such. So Wolff used the term thing in a very broad sense, which means that according to Wolff, what we do in general metaphysics is to investigate the principles that underlie our knowledge of colliding billiard balls, but that equally underlie our knowledge of God or the soul. Yes, so there is no difference between material things on the one hand and immaterial things on the other hand. And of course this is precisely what Kant finds very problematic, because he thinks that our efforts to achieve knowledge of, let's say, immaterial things such as God is illusory and vain. So, as we all know, Kant, in the Critique of Pure Reason, undertakes the task of demonstrating why these a priori principles can only be used with regard to appearances, or you could also say material things. Now, in the Critique of Pure Reason, Kant himself also elaborates, to a certain extent, the discipline that used to be called general metaphysics or ontology. And this is this elaboration consists in his discussion of the categories and their corresponding principles. Yes, pure concepts, such as substance, causality, and necessity, and so on. Now, I propose to refer to this element of the Critique of Pure Reason as Kant's first-order transcendental philosophy. Yes, so Marcus this morning referred to a three-fold distinction in relation to Fichte. I think that I would apply the same threefold distinction to Kant. The first level would be our cognition of, let's say, empirical objects. The second level would be the reflection on the principles of that cognition that takes place in transcendental philosophy or metaphysics. And the second order, the third order reflection would be the question or the investigation as to the possibility of this metaphysics. Yes, but I count a bit differently. I disregard the first level and take and focus on the distinction between two levels within metaphysics itself. So as becomes clear from quotation 5 on your handout, Kant says, well, you know, in the Critique of Pure Reason, I'm only going to deal with this first order transcendental philosophy insofar as this is necessary. Yes, and I will postpone the exhaustive analysis of these concepts to a later work. Yes, and of course, given Kant's metaphysical deduction of the categories, he thought, and I think rightly so, that this system, the complete system of all these, consisting of all these concepts and principles, would be much more rigorous than anything that his predecessors had achieved. Yes, so the complete system of pure reason that Kant intended to elaborate but never did would be the completed first-order transcendental philosophy. Yes, it would be a systematic account of all a priori elements of our cognition of objects. Now, Kant uses the term transcendental cognition also with regard to the second-order reflection on the very possibility of the first order. That is to say, with regard to what I've also called transcendental critique. Yes, it's Kant's term, but I've mentioned it before. That is to say, he used the term transcendental cognition with regard to the critical preliminary reflection on the limits within which the a priori elements of all knowledge can rightfully be employed. This is quotation 6 on your handout. Now, I think it's pretty clear that this second order level, this second order transcendental philosophy, is what distinguishes Kant's Critique of Pure Reason from earlier metaphysical treatises. And it's clear that it constitutes the core of the Critique of Pure Reason. And Kant, in one of his letters to Hertz, refers to this strand of the Critique of Pure Reason as a metaphysics of metaphysics. Yes, and that also illustrates the second order character of it. Now, what's the purpose of this transcendental critique? It is supposed to demonstrate, as I already mentioned, that special metaphysics cannot really achieve what it wants to achieve, that is to say, theoretical cognition of the soul, the world as such, and God. Yes, that's quotation 7 in your handout. Now, that's bad news for some of his contemporaries, but the good news that Kant adds to this is that he says, well, you know, the main issues that used to be treated within special metaphysics from a theoretical perspective can be taken over to the practical part of my system, and within that context we can again think about human freedom, the immortality of the soul, and a divine cause of the world, because without these ideas we as human beings could not interpret ourselves as free and responsible. That's outside of the scope of the paper, but I just wanted to mention that he's destruction of special metaphysics is not a complete destruction. Yes, because the most important elements of it are transferred to the practical philosophy. Okay, so let me sum up this part on Kant. I've argued that we should first of all distinguish between the critique and the system that Kant intended to elaborate on its basis. And what we should also retain is that this transcendental critique aims to restrict the use of pure concepts to the act of establishing unity among our empirical representations. Yes, that's what pure concepts are supposed to do. And then, as regards the system, we know that Kant thought that his metaphysical deduction of the categories would serve as the basis of this future system, and we also know that he thought that the system could acquire more contents by deriving more specific pure concepts from these basic categories. Okay, so I think that these various elements are very relevant to understanding what then happens in the early reception of Kant. And I'll now turn to that question and say one or two things about Jacobi, but very, very briefly. So I take it that Kant's intention to establish a system of pure reason got lost in the debates soon after the Critique of Pure Reason was published. Yes, so much to Kant's regret, his Critique of Pure Reason became known first and foremost for its claim that human knowledge merely pertains to appearances, and this view was often considered to come down to subjectivism, a form of skepticism, or a form of idealism, but in the Berkeleyan sense of the term. Now, I take it that Jacobi, who was of course aware of this, played a role in development of the reception of Kant by as it were confirming this aspect of Kant's Critique of Pure Reason. So first of all, Jacobi, in his appendix to his work on Hume from 87, he refers, I think, systematically to the Kantian system, yes, as if there were such a thing as the Kantian system. And he tells us that this system consists in the claim that the principles of the understanding express merely subjective conditions and are without any true objective content and use. And he says that, moreover, that Kant's system is contradictory and can only become consistent if Kant would give up the view that external objects affect our senses. So what we should do in order to make the Kantian system consistent, he says, is to embrace, quote, the most powerful idealism that has ever been taught, and what should be done is even not to refrain from the reproach of speculative egoism. Yes, so according to Jacobi, that's the only way to save Kantian philosophy, and of course it's a way that he rejects, yes, because he thinks that it leads perhaps to something consistent, but to something that that is horrible, because it's a kind of, it leads to a Spinozistic rationalism which denies any space for freedom and religion and so on. Now, but the point was not lost on people such as Fichte, who indeed tried to make Kant's philosophy, or to show that Kant's philosophy was ultimately consistent. So, very briefly on Fichte, I think that Fichte, after arriving in Jena, realized that he had to do two things to, let's say, save Kant's critical philosophy from its critics. And he wanted to do so in a more convincing way than Reinhold had done prior to him. Now, I think, as said, I think he had to do, he took it that he had to achieve two things. On the one hand, he had to reject Jacobi's claim that Kant's philosophy, as it stands, is inconsistent. On the other hand, he had to take seriously Schulz's claim that Reinhold's principle of consciousness does not really provide philosophy which, with its indubitable principle. Yes, but he took over from Reinhold the view that Kant's philosophy could only be saved by providing it with such a principle. So what is it that Fichte then goes on to do? Well, I think it's presented very nicely in a famous passage from 1797, where Fichte says, well, basically my own system is none other than the Kantian system, but it proceeds in a manner that is entirely independent of Kant's presentation. We see from this quote that Fichte, like Jacobi, refers to the Kantian system. Yes? As if there were such a thing as the Kantian system. Now, I suppose that Fichte was an honest man and that he genuinely thought he was telling the truth, yes, and to render justice where it is due. However, it seems to me that Fichte modified what he took to be the Kantian system much more significantly than he claimed. And especially for the following reason. It seems to me that when Fichte adopted the absolute I as the indubitable principle of his version of the Kantian system, that he gave much more weight to the ego than Kant does in the Critique of Pure Reason. Now, of course, in the Transcendental Deduction, especially in the B edition, Kant does make a number of remarks on transcendental apperception and also on its relation to the categories. And we know that that Fichte read the B edition, in which the role of transcendental apperception is emphasized more than in the first edition. Now I have some doubts about this appropriation of Kant's notion of transcendental apperception for the following reason. It seems to me that that basically Kant discusses transcendental apperception to refer to the principle that allows us to produce systematic unity among our cognitions. Yes, because I have to be able to identify each of my cognitions as mine. However, we cannot isolate what Kant says about this purely intellectual act of self-identification. We cannot isolate this act from other elements of the transcendental deduction, namely what he says about imagination and intuition. Yes, so according to Kant, the transcendental apperception all by itself cannot achieve anything. Yes, it is in a way a highest point, but all by itself it cannot achieve anything. So actually relating to an object or actually carrying out a synthesis requires also intuition and imagination. And this is an aspect that is ignored, it seems to me, by Fichte. Secondly, I hold that it is not really warranted to identify what's at stake in the transcendental deduction with what is at stake in the critique of pure reason as a whole. Yes, so of course I'm not going to deny that the transcendental deduction in its various versions is important, but it seems to me that it does not constitute the core of the critique of pure reason as a whole. Yes, I even think that that Kant, until perhaps 76, 77, thought of the project of the critique of pure reason without having in mind something like the transcendental deduction. And that's why I think that that we cannot simply take transcendental apperception to be the principle of either the critique of pure reason or that which is called the Kantian system. So let me add a few more remarks on how I think that Fichte's philosophy differs from Kant's. First of all, Fichte's intended reconstruction of the system of science, yes, the reconstruction of the system of science that he intends to carry out in the Doctrine of Science, abstracts from the question as to whether pure concepts such as causality, which are treated in general metaphysics, whether such concepts can be used in the natural sciences alone, as Kant is going to conclude, or can be used in special metaphysics as well. Yes, and since this is the question that is well crucial to Kant's transcendental critique, yes, determining whether pure concepts can be used with regard to material objects alone or also with regard to immaterial objects, since this is the question at stake in transcendental critique, Fichte's doctrine of science cannot be called critical in this Kantian sense. So it's not a form of critical philosophy in the Kantian sense. Secondly, it seems to me that Kant did not want to reduce the various faculties of the human mind to a single source, as Fichte seems to do. Yes, so Kant precisely distinguishes these various faculties, the understanding, reason, imagination, intuition, in order to investigate their specific contribution to cognition, and on that basis to determine to what extent synthetic a priori cognition is possible. So since Fichte purports to derive these various faculties from a single source, he in my way blurs the Kantian distinction between critique and system in another way. And the third point I have already mentioned, basically, I don't think that Kant wanted to provide his future system with a foundation similar to the one that Fichte derives from Kant's account of transcendental apperception. And of course, this is what Fichte claims. Yes, he says, well, Kant didn't quite get where he wanted to go, but basically it's clear that if Kant had developed his system, he would have adopted something like the absolute I as the fundamental principle of everything that would follow. And I think that there is no reason, given what Kant says, to agree with Fichte on this point. Yes, so I think that the system such as Kant envisioned it, at least in 1781, would have been very similar to the Wolffian metaphysics of his predecessors, and he would not have started, I think, from something like transcendental apperception or the absolute I. There's no reason to believe that he would have done so. So I take it basically that whatever he says about transcendental apperception belongs to the critical strand of the critique of pure reason and not to its systematic strand. Okay. So as regards Kant's distinction between critique and system, I think that he is pretty consistent in this regard. And for instance, there is a passage in the introduction to the third critique, quotation 11 on your handout, which at first sight might suggest that he gives up his earlier view, but I don't think that this is the case. Yes, if you read the passage carefully. So he says that it is necessary to deal with the power of judgment as a special part of a critique of pure reason, here taken in a very broad sense. But he goes on to say the principles of this power of judgment, yes, the topic of the third critique, may not constitute a special part of a system of pure philosophy between the theoretical and the practical part. And then he simply reiterates his earlier view on this system. Yes, it should consist of two parts, a theoretical and a practical part, and the complete production of it is entirely possible and no big deal. And he also reiterates the function that he attributes to critique. Now, it seems to me that the precise meaning of Kant's distinction between critique and system was not perceived by most of the commentators, including Fichte. As we saw, I think yesterday morning, yesterday afternoon, Fichte does distinguish between critique and system. But I think that that nevertheless, Fichte attributes certain characteristics to the Kantian system that he's going to complete that Kant would attribute to the critical strand of the critique of pure reason alone. Yes, and one of these elements I already mentioned, namely transcendental apperception or the absolute I. Some people, and perhaps many of them, assume that Kant at some point changed his mind, that he gave up his earlier position as to the relation between critique and system. And one of the sources, or perhaps the most important source for this view that Kant changed his mind, is in quotation 12 on your handout, which is taken from Kant's open letter to Fichte, from 99, something like that. And this, I'd like to dwell on this particular passage because I think it has caused a lot of misunderstanding until today. So I will first read my own translation, which is 12b, and then go back to the German. The first part is unproblematic. So Kant says, in his open letter to Fichte, I have to add that the unwarranted claim, according to which I merely should have wanted to deliver a propedeutic to transcendental philosophy and not the actual system itself, is incomprehensible to me. That is to say, Kant says, I have always wanted to publish both a critique and a system, which is the complete form of transcendental philosophy. Yes, transcendental philosophy in the sense of first-order transcendental philosophy. Such an intention could never have occurred to me, says Kant. Yes, that's very clear. Then he offers his reason why he could not have made that claim. He says, since I myself, in the Critique of Pure Reason, have lauded, gepriesen, have lauded the completed whole of pure philosophy as the best indication of the truth of this philosophy. Yes? So I take Kant to say, simply, look at my introduction to the Critique of Pure Reason. There you will find passages in which I argue that a transcendental philosophy is only complete if it develops into a full system, which I'm going to deliver at some point. Yeah? However, the passage has been misinterpreted. Also by contemporary commentators and translators. So in the Cambridge translation by Zweig, you find, I think, the standard rendering of the passage, which I take to be completely wrong, which is as follows. Such an intention could never have occurred to me, since I took the completeness of pure philosophy within the Critique of Pure Reason to be the best indication of the truth of that work. Yes? So, but perhaps the Kant's German is not absolutely clear, but I think it's not ambivalent. Yes, so according to the commentators and this translator, Kant claims that that we find in the Critique of Pure Reason the completeness of pure philosophy, whereas I argue that Kant is merely saying, I have talked about the complete whole of pure philosophy as the best indication of the truth of that philosophy. So Marx agrees with me, so the job is done. I can add that a friend of Kant's, Melin, wrote a letter referring to all the fuss that the letter has caused, and saying to Kant, well, can you imagine, they're all misinterpreting what you said in your letter, because they, and this is not in the handout, because man meint die Behauptung darin zu finden, sie hätten bereits das vollständige und ausführliche System der Transzendentalphilosophie geliefert, welches, according to Melin, doch mit so vielen Stellen der Kritik in Widerspruch stehe. Yes, so he says, well, we all know that this is not what you wanted to say. How can they misread the passage? And then Zweig, so the translator of the Cambridge correspondence, he has a note, which I will also read. So Zweig adds, Kant's claim here is contradicted by many passages from the first critique. So he tells us, look at Kant, you know, he had become very old, he's saying something completely different from what he said in the Critique of Pure Reason. But the funny thing is that Zweig almost literally repeats what Melin reported to Kant. Yes? So, and I also know of at least of two recent commentators who also read the passage in the wrong way, thus perpetuating the view that Kant changed his mind as to the relation between critique and system. Okay, let me move on. Yeah. Yes, so my point is basically that Fichte misinterprets certain elements of Kant's philosophy, but I don't want to argue that he misinterprets Kant completely. Yes, I think that he has had profound insights in certain issues at stake in the Critique of Pure Reason, which Kant was not able to further elaborate, and perhaps did not want or did not need to elaborate, given his own purposes. But nevertheless, I would defend the specific character of Kant's notion of system against what we find in Fichte. On the other hand, however, I think that there is a great advancement in Fichte's philosophy with regard to Kant's, because Fichte has a much more precise understanding of what of the nature of the philosophy carried out in the Critique of Pure Reason and also in Fichte's own versions of the doctrine of essence. Yes, so Fichte is very much aware that philosophy reconstructs, well, a system of knowledge that is already there and only has to well, present its various elements in a systematic manner. Moreover, Fichte, I think, is the first to develop a method that allows philosophy to actually derive one conceptual determination from another. And this is a method that we don't find in Kant, and that is, I think, well, that we find in a much more sophisticated version in Hegel's logic, but it's clearly Fichte who, in that regard, with regard to the method of philosophy, introduces something new that that is exciting and offers possibilities that were not available to Kant. Okay, so I now move to Hegel, and I'll try to be brief. And I will focus on Hegel's Science of Logic because Hegel, in the introduction to this work, presents the logic as metaphysics proper, or the system of pure reason, the realm of pure thought. This is not on your handout. So in that regard, it's clear that Hegel saw a very strong relation between Hegel's logic, between his own logic, and Kant's transcendental philosophy. And he also avows his debt to Kant in a more positive sense by maintaining, and this is quotation 16 on your handout, that the first two parts of the Science of Logic, that is to say the objective logic, partly corresponds, sorry, it's not, that part is not exactly in your quote 16. But anyway, so he states that the objective logic partly corresponds to Kant's transcendental logic. And then he goes on, and this is in the quote, to describe what Kant means by transcendental logic. And he says it contains the rules of the pure thinking of an object, but at the same time, it treats of the origin of our cognition insofar as it cannot be ascribed to the objects. Yes, now this latter point, this discussion of the origin of our cognition, refers to Kant's discussion of the various faculties of the human mind, which in my view is part of the critical part of Kant's Critique of Pure Reason, and not of the, let's say, of transcendental philosophy proper. But Hegel doesn't seem to recognize this, and he says, well, Kant's perspective is limited or problematic because he focused exclusively on this investigation of the subjective sources of cognition, and what he failed to do was to treat these pure concepts as they are in and for themselves. Yes, so he basically identifies Kant's project, I think, way too much with its critical strands, which involves the investigation of the various faculties, yes, and he ignores that Kant's system would have treated the totality of pure concepts without taking into account their subjective sources. Yes, so Kant's system would exactly have done what Hegel thinks he is doing and what he's doing differently from Kant, namely developing a system in which the pure concepts are treated as they are in themselves, that is to say, independently of the question as to how they are actually being produced by the human mind. Yes, so like Fichte, I think Hegel does not really take into account Kant's understanding of the distinction between critique and system. Yes, blurs the distinction, basically. So Hegel takes himself to be able to move beyond Kant by getting rid of the alleged subjectivism of Kant's transcendental logic, and by treating these concepts as they are in and for themselves. Now, as I've argued, that in my view, this is exactly what Kant also intended to do. So if we take that for granted, yes, and I hope you're convinced by my analysis so far, then it's no longer very easy to determine the exact distinction between Kant's system, yes, that he never elaborated, on the one hand, and Hegel's science of logic, on the other hand. Because they both do what general metaphysics always wanted to do, namely to offer a systematic account of the totality of pure concepts constitutive of our knowledge of objects. So in that regard, Wolffian metaphysics, Kantian or Kant's future system, and Hegel's science of logic have a lot in common. Yes, that's what I wanted to bring out as to the continuity between Wolffian metaphysics and Hegelian logic. Of course, there are also important differences, and these differences have to do, I think, with the way in which they assess let me put it a bit differently. They vary in their assessment of the way in which pure concepts can actually be used. Yes, Wolff thought they can be used for any purpose. Yes, whether billiard balls or God. Kant says no, these pure concepts can only be used with regard to possible objects of experience. And then my question, the last question that I'll try to discuss here, and again very briefly, is there, of course, the question, well, how does Hegel go about it? Yes, how does Hegel deal with this question as to the actual use of pure concepts? Now, Hegel does not discuss this theme in a very explicit manner, but I take it that he succeeds in incorporating that which Kant calls critique into his systematic analysis of these pure concepts in a very interesting manner. And so I now come to quote 17 on the handout. He says that, and this is from the Encyclopedia, he says that what the speculative philosopher does is to consider each and every pure concept in such a way that these concepts themselves are forced, as it were, to reflect on themselves and to ask themselves the question, this is something I add, am I able to determine the absolute, or am I not? Yes, so we perhaps might sometimes ask ourselves similar questions, but Hegel stages the concepts in such a way that, and now I quote from quote 17, that the forms of thought, that is to say the pure concepts, examine themselves. They are to determine their own limit by themselves and lay bare their own defects. Yes, and that, I think, is a very remarkable quote that I think throws light on what's actually going on in the science of logic. Yes, so take a concept such as causality. The very concept of a cause seems to imply that there is a difference between the cause and its effect. Yes, now if we consider this difference, then we should come to the conclusion, or the concept of causality itself should come to the conclusion, that it is, at least in that capacity, is not able to be an adequate determination of the absolute, because the absolute is self-causing. Yes, so insofar as the concept of causality implies a distinction between the cause and its effect, implies that the effect is something else than the cause, it can be used to determine the relation between colliding billiard balls, but it cannot be used, it meets its own limits when it is being applied to something like God. Now, of course, there would be much more to say about this, but in view of the time, I should try to conclude. So it seems to me that Hegel further develops something that is already in place in Fichte's method, that is to say, a way of presenting pure concepts in such a way that one concept necessarily pushes against its own limits, because it is not, it turns out not to be an adequate determination of, let's say, the absolute I or the absolute as such. So I take it that Hegel further develops this methodological principle, and by doing so completely integrates the two elements that in Kant are kept apart, namely critique and system. Yes. So by letting every concept enact a certain kind of self-criticism, Hegel is able precisely to let to actually derive a specific conceptual determination from a preceding one, so as to establish a complete system of pure reason. So, seen in this way, Hegel's logic is both a first-order metaphysics, yes, it treats of the totality of pure concepts, and a second-order metaphysics of metaphysics in the Kantian sense of the term. Yes, and the two elements, as said, are completely integrated. Since neither of these two strands purport to achieve a priori knowledge of particular objects, such as the soul or God, the science of logic does not succumb to the transcendental illusion that, according to Kant, had prevented metaphysics from becoming a science. Yes, so Hegel's logic does not is not vulnerable to Kant's criticism of former special metaphysics, because it doesn't posit objects such as God. So in that case, you know, there's nothing that Kant could have held against Hegel's logic. However, Kant himself would probably not have recognized the science of logic as a work that accomplishes the system of pure reason to which he, in the Critique of Pure Reason, alludes as the promised land. Thank you.